About a year before he proposed his 32 questions for propagandists, Jarrah White offered his 32 conspiracist claims in his masterful work, MoonFaker, Exhibit D. In his 12-part series, Jarrah White attacks the three main facts that propagandists point to as evidence that the moon landings are real: moon rocks, lunar laser ranging, and mission telecommunications. According to Jarrah, the moon rocks are obviously a collection of meteorites mixed in with Earth material. The laser retroreflectors are simply not needed to bounce lasers off the moon's surface. And all the telemetry, audio, and video received by mission control during the 9 Apollo missions that went to the moon came off a pre-recorded master tape. The entire series runs just over 2 hours, if you include the credits, so doing a play-by-play debunking is totally out of the question. Fortunately, Jarrah repeats himself quite often and likes to include huge chunks of extraneous copyrighted material, so the task of debunking is not as bad as it sounds. Overall, he came up with over 30 unique reasons that prove, in his naive little mind anyway, that the entire historical record is false. He also identifies about 20 different scientists and engineers by name and calls them all liars. Most notably, Jay Wendley, Phil Plate, and Robert Brannig, because they typically manage to spread the most gloom and doom on Jarrah's parade. In summary, his 32 irrefutable reasons why the propagandists' collective body of evidence is bogus include: on moon rocks, NASA's moon rocks have water in them. NASA's moon rocks have identical elements and isotopes to Earth rocks. Earth materials were doped with helium-3 to make them look like they came from the moon. Materials found in NASA's moon rocks that are not also found in Earth rocks are common to meteorites. Wernher von Braun collected the moon rocks on a trip to Antarctica. Meteorites found on Earth were made to look like moon rocks by chipping away their fusion crust. NASA's moon rocks and Earth rocks have different elements and isotopes in them. NASA's moon rocks show significant signs of oxidation. Only a handful of pro-NASA geologists have ever looked at NASA's moon rocks. NASA's moon rocks were shot with aluminum pellets to simulate micrometeoroid impacts. The Soviets never went to the moon. Instead, they ground down a few grams of NASA's moon rocks to create their lunar samples. SMART-1 uncovered minerals different from those found in NASA's moon rocks. The minerals discovered by SMART-1 agree with the Soviet samples, and both are different from NASA's moon rocks. On lunar laser ranging, LLR does not prove astronauts walked on the moon. Reflectors could have been placed by unmanned craft. Reflectors are not needed to bounce lasers off the moon. The Mythbusters cheated when they did their LLR demonstration. Most of what he says here about the retroreflectors is repeated word for word in MoonFaker LRO Laser Reflector Oddity, so we may lump that video in with our Exhibit D critique. On mission telecommunications, the only station receiving radio transmissions was Parkes in Australia. Simulated data came into mission control from the Tetra A satellite. Simulated data was fed into the ground station's S-band antenna via telephone lines. Signals were rebroadcast from satellites to fool the amateur radio operators. The Apollo spacecraft transmitted at exactly 2 GHz. Amateur radio operators could not have picked up Apollo transmissions because they don't use 2 GHz. Jordell Bank didn't have their radio telescope tuned to exactly 2 GHz either, so they couldn't have picked up the Apollo transmissions. The Soviets could not have picked up the Apollo transmissions because they don't use 2 GHz to track their own satellites. The Soviets are stupid. They couldn't even track their own spacecraft, so how could they track Apollo? Jordell Bank did not track Apollo all the way to the moon and back. The Apollo signals were bounced off a satellite orbiting the moon. Jarrah also goes off on several tangents, including, but not in any means limited to, the astronauts never left the ground. The Apollo 15 command module was dropped out of a C-5A and witnessed by a pilot and several other people. The astronauts never left Earth orbit. the radiation would have killed the astronauts. Although these tangential items are not related to the main subject of Exhibit D in even a remote way, I consider them fair game for critique. Also, you may have noticed that Jarrah does a lot of covering the bases, so to speak, by attempting to discredit the evidence with seemingly totally contradictory arguments. NASA's moon rocks are fake whether they are identical to Earth rocks or not. NASA's moon rocks are fake whether they are identical to the Soviet moon samples or not. Telemetry was fed to Mission Control by an Earth-orbiting satellite, and via telephone wires, and they were bounced off satellites orbiting the moon. Apollo transmissions were rebroadcast from satellites to fool the amateur radio operators, who were unable to receive the signals. The astronauts never left the ground, except when they never left low Earth orbit. Now, although these contradictory arguments could easily be debunked by simply slamming them against each other, like matter and antimatter, I intend to give each claim the individual attention it rightly deserves. Over the next month or so, I will attempt to address each of Jarrah's 32 points, some more briefly than others, and show how easily each and every one can be discredited using little more than the actual sources that Jarrah misquotes. We will also highlight as many logical fallacies and demonstrate how even an unobservant propagandist, such as myself, can easily identify them. I hope you will enjoy this series, Debunking MoonFaker Exhibit D. It's going to be fun. For me, at least. And, except for the section on lunar laser ranging, it requires almost no math. So, stay tuned. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators. Wherever you are.